Hey guys. Talking about making hydrocarbons and oil and hydrogen and preventing mega volcanoes like Yellowstone that, you know, goes off every half million years. It's 780,000 overdue now. So, I mean, these things happening and then that's it. Most if not, hey guys, stay here. Most if not everything gone and extinct. If you got hands and shovels and caves and, you know, hydroponics and, you know, energy supplies and seeds and whatnot, you can survive a remnant of you, like we did. So this, I guess, would be Doc Atomics goes back to Atlantis to help us all make hydrogen. Yeah. So as you can propel yourself out into the universe to serve life into it, right? Can't do that if you're extinct, can you? No. Hey, you guys want to join the party here? We're down at the duck pond. We'll give you a few before we finish up. Yeah, so what you want to do is you want to take water and you want to apply energy to it and get it to split into hydrogen and oxygen, basically, is the short of it. You can use electricity in our electrolysis or something a little more energetic. Heat it up. I mean, just plain pure water itself starts breaking down into hydrogen at about 2000 Celsius, which is a pretty hard heat to get unless you, you know, go nuclear or go deep down, right? An example of nuclear would be making hydrogen, which coincidentally is part of the next generation, the fourth generation of nuclear reactor to try and sell. Well, we can make clean hydrogen with it to burn your mobile sources like cars on, and buses and trucks. That'll be one of their selling points. But I get back onto it, not diverge too far. You know, the reactors, that's how they blew up, because if they get hot enough, you know, anything even close to 2000, it actually can be down to as low as, like, this is important for sustainable energy now, solar energy heat, can get down to as low as 400 Celsius if you've got copper sulfate in the water, and you'll start getting the electrolysis, and the copper sulfate doesn't get used up, right? It just phase changes, and, along with the hydrogen and the oxygen, and, you know, goes into like H3O and shit like that. Hydrogen, the main thing, a lot of it. Of course, you can do it with solar electricity, you know, if you wanted, rather than, so you can use a wide range of temperatures, you know, anything up to like 3,000 degrees would be about the biggest temperature you'd want to deal with, because then you got to go to carbon pipes and whatnot, fancy carbon molecules, to withstand that kind of heat and pressure, right? And go down like, you know, below 10 miles, where things are getting pretty soft and fluidy, which is where you can really get the power. So, you know, you can inject shit in like iron oxide into your pure water. And bring the temperature down to 1200 Celsius, well, lower, but that's a good temperature to work with, to where you're getting not electrolysis, but with heat only. They like to call it thermolysis, if you want to, you know, WikiLeaks it. I'll put some links conveniently in the more information. You know, with whole tables, all the different, you know, there's like quite a few well known and documented chemical formulations you can put in, like magnesium sulfate, for instance, into the water, salt, you know, and then you get hydrogen and chlorine gas with salt water. And you can use a little electricity and a little heat to make electricity a little less, that way a little less efficient, you know, in combinations. So you can use electrolysis and chemosis and thermosis. Like chemosis would be like copper sulfate in your water or iron oxide in your water. Now getting down to practical terms, you know, you got iron oxide. Once you know how to read what's under the ground, you got all that shit. You know, like basically below your water wells, that's how a lot of that hydrocarbons got in there with that. Those rich carbon sources where it congealed into, in the heat and the pressure, into petroleum oil. Which, yeah, granted it acted like a solvent for any organic matter that happened to be down there, you know, like dinosaur bones. But that's not where the hydrocarbons came from. Hydrogen first splitting from water that got subdued down into the crust. It's where it gets too hot and you get all the hydrogen coming out. And oxygen, you know. Which is very explosive, which is, you know, kind of how, that's part of volcanic explosions. Part of it, you know. You get steam, and once you get that steam hot enough, basically, in the case of a nuclear pile, Fukushima reactors again, you get, you boil out all the water, so finally the temperatures can get up there to where they'll make a flash spark, and now you got HHO from splitting the water, kaboom, right? That's already, you know, maybe it's already at, you know, 10,000 psi or something, or 1,000 psi even, or 100. And it blows your reactor up, and that's what happened at Fukushima. So, you know, it's not without its challenges. That's certainly not. I want to make HHO, brown gas. I want to make that around nuclear fuel that I can't yet, haven't learned how to control in my biosphere. No. Maybe that hasn't appealed to you, Agenda 21, this, but to we survivalists that like to follow the first meaning of life, survival of all, we, hey bud, we don't dig that idea. So how can you make it? Well, dig down around, well, you know, you're already doing it in a little places, but do a lot more of it. You know, dig down and cool the rock around the big calderas that are dangerous. Yellowstone in the United States Midwest is not the only one that would, you know, before it's taken out North America, the last two times it blew up everything. Put Earth into a nuclear winter scenario, well, volcanic winter. although there's nukes that come out of that too. You know, and that's generally a mantle welling up, and occasionally it's natural uranium and thorium fission, to where it gets enough of it in one place that happens to get hot enough as it makes its way to the core, only it's, you know, still not that far down. That's sometimes where you get magma chambers, as well as uranium thorium comets coming from large supernovas that make it into a planet's crust. And then when the conditions are right, you know, it can go critical. And water, it can get water, and you know, once it gets up to that, steam's up to like 2,000 degrees, it's splitting into hydrogen and oxygen, don't matter what. Maybe sooner if you've exposed it to a catalyzing effect like iron oxide in water, or again, copper sulfate. I don't know, if there's interest, or maybe someone else wants to run with this, I suppose eventually I might find time to make some pictures and describe things a little better, but combine what you know about that, about what they do for oil well, and, you know, a lot of these oil wells fields, they already have the cap, right? And that's the whole thing, so the hydrogen gets trapped. They've got the structure of limestone and whatnot over, and it's not just the cap, it's also the structure of it. See, when you have a carbon source, and we'll get into that, you can change things into hydrocarbon and make it a little more stable. You dig even deeper, because below that were all that oil, that hydrocarbon was, that was basically thermosis, thermochemosis, you know, where the chemicals were, right, like an ore body, an iron ore body or something, or an aluminum or a bauxite body or a copper body, copper sulfur body. And the water was right, at, even at those lower temperatures, you know, 1,000 degrees, 400 degrees Fahrenheit, but it was a copper outcropping and water got in there. Well, that's it, you know, you could get your hydrogen, your HHO generator, your hydrogen oxygen, your splitting water chamber built up. So we can do that, and you have to know your shit, and we can do it safely. Doing it by nuclear reactors that we're using to boil water for electricity. No. Because it includes, the designs includes dealing with conditions that are a lot harsh to control a meltdown. You know, you might be dealing with salt that's 1200 degrees instead of 500 degree water in your nuclear reactor today. So, you know, I have no confidence in their ability to build fault-proof or so redundant for any scenario, for obvious reasons. Right, General Electric? Okay, there's a bit of a downside to this. See, after going back a spell there, you know, after all the space weather came in 80,000 years ago from supernova remnants, and that supernova in the Scorpius-Centaurus association direction that went off 3 million years ago, you know, starting with the iron 60 layer down in ocean sediments, shit like that. I won't go on and on. Go to Dr. Paul LaViolette's work. I'll put a link down there. And do his ice cores, and that'll help clue you into what the weather was actually like when all this went down. And, you know, 80,000 years ago, that's when we started dealing with this local interstellar cloud, this veil, which is the supernova remnant. And now we're dealing with another edge of it, which is where shit happens. You know, your Ragnarok storms. So what happened, going back to Atlantis here now, you know, when the Syrians came over, the Dagons came over from Sirius C and started to try and recraft humans, hominids, and came up with Homo sapien and whatnot, you know, about 8,000 years ago. Well, actually it started about 12,000 years ago when they started to reverse the glaciation, and now we're getting to the point here, basically, you know, making hydrogen on a terraforming scale. Basically the what in Plato's and whatnot, your typical classical Atlantis, that was in the northern end of the South Atlantic. You know, with the southern end of it being like St. Helena and upwards. You know, basically they it kind of went a little too rampant, and selecting that spot because the crust was so thin and easy to manage, and well, they basically cooled a little too much of it, and Atlantis literally sunk, and it's still sinking today. But now it's about ready to change, and this happens, like the Tibet Plateau, this is the same kind of geology that happens, where you subduct too much of a landmass. In this case, they were cooling the bottom of it, so, you know, they were pushing the landmass up, Atlantis was going up and up, because they're cooling the bottom. And when you cool a mass like an iceberg, it becomes less dense, because it crystallizes and it starts to float up, because it's now less dense. Okay, but then after all this terraforming was shut down, this mass hydrogen and oxygen generator, and the hydrogen was to get the shields back up, right? Because the northern hemisphere was still in glaciation till about 14,000 years ago when they started to melt it pretty good. Well, yeah, 16, I guess it all started, but. So the iceberg keeps going, and then eventually they shut the operation down and whatnot, and what you're kind of left with now is that bottom, you subduct too much solidified landmass, and eventually the heat starts to melt it off, like in a lava lamp. Think of a lava lamp, right? So that's where we're at today. There's this huge, about 88% of it, glob that's being molted and melted, and that's starting to pinch off like a lava lamp bubble. And as it does, Atlantis is literally, okay, this is the fucked up part. What was that guy making all the, trying to tell you guys the story? That American? Oh, well, it doesn't matter. It's one of them. You go into his trances and whatnot. So you get Atlantis rising again, and that's exactly what you're gonna get. You know, Ascension Island, St. Helens, all down in that area, where the South Atlantic gravitational anomaly is, what's causing that. That's because now you're gonna get, you know, a real thin piece of crust, and a denser part that's now been melted and compressed back down, and is now dense, and it wants to recycle and go back down and find its buoyancy again, right? And that'll cause untold earthquake damages when it finally, the process accelerates to its peak. I mean, that's what's actually happening. And they're working on getting a good picture of it to share with you guys all, but that's the same one that is quite incidental to the polar shift, which is, you know, the whole overall thing of that, of course, is the local interstellar cloud having its effect, its gravitational, magnetic, and energetic influence on the entire solar system's magnetic center of gravities. Can I use that? Center of magnetisms? Magnetic poles, magnetic axes. Each planet has a different one, and it's never the same, but always changing. In a spiral that's kind of toe and nail to the way we spiral in orbit around the sun. And the sun doesn't go in a straight orbit either. It also corkscrews, like a picture of sperm on a slide. No, I haven't looked at my own sperm on a slide. I don't have a microscope handy. But I've seen it on PBS television. So, you know, that's kind of one of the things, but that was a mass thing, and, you know, taking way too much heat out of the system, enough that would make major changes, and this change will happen when, well, let's, you know, it'll probably be a cascading failure thing, and triggered by other events when it does happen. Certainly within centuries or millennium. Need a better look to say when. I don't think anyone can say when. Will we notice it? Well, yeah, because you do, even when a place like Yellowstone or Krakatoa warms up. Krakatoa was a small one. The one 80,000 years ago, well, you know, 76,000 years ago was like kind of, as I mentioned before, the telltale when we started tangling with local interstellar cloud, which is a supernova remnant, right, from a supernova. You know, that was one of the things, all the volcanism, that the upset and the extra inclusion of cosmic rays that the upset to the astrosphere caused, and, you know, Earth's magnetosphere too. Those the holy comforters, right? Shields. That's what set off the big volcano then that really set the extinction in toll. Put us right smack into the extinction level, and we were at the peak of Milankovitch, like we are now, which is, you know, the 41,000 years influence on Earth's axis orientation to the sun, according to where everything is. You know, the sun, the planets like Jupiter and whatnot, and where the sun is in its spiral through local interstellar space, through its star system, our star system. So, you know, there you go, there's your energy. But you have to, you know, it's going to take a little work to get there, but it's better investing in something real like that, on no longer having to import energy to where you'll have endless energy. And you can take a lot out. You know, when they were terraforming and leaving us with this problem to inherit, that was like, you know, thousands of times higher rate of hydrogen production than we could possibly fathom needing, even to fuel our spaceships and, you know, make Montonic hydrogen for rocket fuel and yes, in the end, floating homes, sky homes, floating sky ships. Yeah, too bad hydrogen's explosive, eh? Well, we'll just leave it at that. Let's give you a little, see if we can catch any of the winds here coming back. Can make hydrogen, you can, and you can prevent the next extinction levels out of Yellowstone and out of all those places, Japan. Everybody could solve it. And you don't have to go down to the levels to, like I was cautioning you on. Yeah, of course there's dangers. You have to know what kind of changes you're setting about when you move energy around. I'll leave you some links and more information if anyone wants to read very brief summaries to get them started on the hard science. But this isn't complicated shit. It's stuff that's been greatly discouraged, you know, including like why they spent so much effort fucking over Iceland and trying to destroy it and set it up and get it to hang itself. Well, what do you mean you don't buy energy? You could in fact export it if you want to, because you're using very primitive 1960s technology. You're harnessing, you're close to the surface geothermal and made a hydrogen economy, even though you live in a cold climate and you run your greenhouses on that, and you don't buy any petroleum anymore. What? Okay, so you can see why Iceland is set up, right? Because we all know what the number one staple is, you know, beyond the their heroin habits is oil for these parasitic ruling elite. But, you know, they can deal with their own problems. Fuck them. We'll just go ahead and do this. And you can raise all kinds of stocks for fucking Ponzi schemes, you know. And I'm not just saying Bitcoin, because the experiment had merit. But all kinds of inflated stocks and bullshit, and you put your money in the hands of the suit and ties. There's no reason why state of Wyoming couldn't issue bonds for this like that. And invested in a state energy program and start harnessing some of that energy, and everyone that surrounds that. All Utah, sorry, I don't mean to sound ignorant. Wyoming, Kansas. There you go. Oops. Stop importing energy, start exporting energy, and leading the way. Instead of putting your money in offshore Ponzi schemes with guys in suit and ties that you never meet and that trade through stock exchanges, buy shares in your own energy, state energy cooperative. Don't make it a corporation per se, but a cooperative to where you all buy shares to where you can decide how it's going to proceed and be sustainable for your grandchildren's great 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 grandchildren that didn't go extinct because you didn't do anything. Profitable and wise to deal with Yellowstone before it exploded. That's where the dinosaurs went wrong. You all get me, eh? So, and y'all know how you, by keeping all that energy money in your own country, how you can quickly pull yourselves out of the rut. And don't worry about the Chinese people and the Asian people. They'll kick all these crazy bullheads that thought they had themselves a new crop of slaves. They'll send them packing, and then they'll be ready to deal too, and there'll be so much more that we can deal with them. Now, look, get to some serious what fully enabled beings do. They seek knowledge, and then they figure out how to do this shit. They build the infrastructure, which begins with creating how to do this shit. There's absolutely no reason to be fighting over created scarcity when what did they want with the oil in Iraq? Take it out of fucking production and create scarcity, right? Because, that's why they said American State Department, April Gillespie said, yeah, okay, go ahead, days before before CIA operative Saddam Hussein in Iraq took Iraq into the neighboring country, Kuwait, to take some border disputed oil fields, and realizing he had to go all the way because they would quickly kick his ass back out if he just stopped at the edge of the oil fields that he claimed were Iraq's. Go ahead, take that Kuwaiti oil, but take it out of production, because the price of oil is going down to 24 a barrel here, and we're having to close our domestic wells and cap them. We got to have at least $26-$28 a barrel to make a profit. So go ahead, Sudan. And then as soon as he did, well, they took his and everyone's oil out of production, and Saddam's oil, Iraq's oil, and Kuwait's oil got all blowed up because that was part of the deal. I mean, in fact, who knows, maybe they sent somebody like Kraft or Hoots and Coots or whatever into SEAL Team 66 in or whatever to blow all those oil wells up. Maybe that wasn't even Saddam doing that, because that was the whole objective. Take that fucking shit out of fucking production. We're going broke here. There's too much oil on the glut. So, just fuck all that. Okay, go ahead, you fuckers. You got your billions, your trillions. Fuck you, worst state. That's ours. We're fucking making hydrogen, and we're going to pipe it out, and we're going to create electricity from the steam heat. We're going to get all kinds of minerals out of the what comes up. We're going to send CO2 down to get rid of it in the fracking process when we're drilling these wells and starting them up. Okay, and we're going to bring up whatever minerals we're targeting, and these are usually going to be below oil. A good place to look is where you already have the hydrogen vent holes drilled, where you were taking your gas off of the old oil wells. You just got to, probably if you go, not probably, there's no doubt about it, right below your feet is lava. You don't want to go that far, but, you know, some places a few kilometers, some places like 10 kilometers, you start going down that far, and now you're talking like 2,000 degrees Celsius. You frack the rock, and you start injecting your water through the right kind of rock, ideally, or you can add solution. You can add copper sulfate, you can add iron, whatever you want, whatever's best to make it sustainable. And you do this around areas where you want to change the earthquakes, and you want to stop explosive volcanoes that are deadly. You know, you still need some of those, because that does changes in the earth that it needs, but, you know, and make no doubt about it, if you change this, you may have to spend effort doing this. But the whole thing is you got to do something, and can you do it and make a profit? And this is going to give you all that energy and all those minerals and metals, plus save your asses. Now, if you can take your tax dollars and your pension money and all that shit and invest it in the military-industrial complex, and then have your taxes pay for it, and your grandchildren's pensions pay for it, and their medicals pay for it, and their schooling pay for going to war now to cause created scarcity. Because war's good for the economy? What the fuck? Are you cooked? Yeah, well, so is shit like this. This is much, much, much gooder for the economy. Right? Got it? Got it? Alright, enough said. Go make hydrogen and invest in something that's going to pay you dividends in the future. This shit is...